take a couple of moments and just quiet our hearts as we get ready to shift into our first set of worship songs. Let me just ask you to close your eyes for a moment. And let's take a few deep breaths. Think about why we are here today. We're here to worship our Lord, to give Him praise. Father, we pray that You would prepare our hearts for this service. We pray that Your Spirit would be here. We pray that we would leave encouraged and empowered to help advance Your kingdom. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to give you a warning up front. Today's sermon is going to feel just a little bit different. It's going to feel like a report at the beginning and a sermon at the end. So just want to kind of set your expectations for that. If you were here last week, you know that toward the end of the service, I mentioned a few possible topics that I was thinking of addressing and asked for some feedback. And I said, I'm thinking about three topics. I've got two Sundays. My topics are possibly loneliness, or a message on political engagement, or a message on how to discern what is true, particularly in light of artificial intelligence and all the misinformation that's out there. And here's what happened. One person came up and said, I think you ought to do all three. And I looked out, and that person's not here this week. but anyway, one person said, I think you should do all three. Another person wanted the message on determining what was true. So I have a hard time just knowing what's true. There's so much information out there, so many books. I'm not sure what is true. But several people mentioned politics, and when they mentioned politics, it was either please do it or heaven forbids don't. So I got feedback on both sides of that. But the one thing that came up most often was loneliness. And a number of people said, I think the topic that needs to be addressed is this idea of there being an epidemic of loneliness. I noted that toward the end of 2023, Dr. Vivek Murthy, our Surgeon General, declared that loneliness is an epidemic. And let me read a few words from a report that he issued. He issued an 84-page report on the epidemic of loneliness. Let me just read a section of what he said. He said, when I first took office as Surgeon General in 2014, I didn't view loneliness as a public health concern. But that was before I embarked on a cross-country listening tour where I heard story after story from my fellow Americans that surprised me. People began to tell me that they felt isolated, invisible, insignificant. Even when they couldn't put their finger on the word lonely, time and time again, people of all ages and socioeconomic backgrounds from every country, from every corner of the country would tell me, I have to shoulder all of life's burdens by myself. Or if I disappear tomorrow, no one will even notice. There is a stigma to admitting to others that we are lonely. It's okay to admit that we are depressed or to admit that we are anxious or that we are struggling in some other area, but I think it is particularly hard to openly acknowledge that we are lonely. And I think there are a couple of reasons for that. One is it invites overly simplistic answers like, why don't you join a bowling league? So people don't want to admit it because it's like, okay, you're just going to give me some cliche, and it's better than hearing nothing than hearing something that's shallow and not helpful at all. So I think that's one reason. But I think there's another reason that's even more difficult, and that is that I think it opens the door to much more painful questions. If we admit that we're lonely, it leads to questions like, is there something wrong with me? Is there something about me that is unlovable? And those are embedded in humanity. Those are deeply human questions that I think everyone wrestles with. But this idea of being lonely really, really pulls them to the surface, and they are hard. Loneliness taps into that part of our being that reflects the image of God, a longing to be in relationship and to experience intimacy. The big idea for today's message is that God sees and cares about lonely people. If you are lonely today, God sees you, and he's aware of that, and he cares about it. And it may not always feel that way. Psalm 25:16 says, "Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted." So loneliness was something that even King David struggled with. You think of King David, probably the wealthiest person in much of the world at that time, surrounded by people, and yet David declared that he struggled, even though he's surrounded by people, with the feeling of being alone. Let's start with a definition of loneliness. Number one, loneliness and being alone are not the same thing. Christ taught us that in the right amount and at the right time, it is good for us to be alone. There are 9 times in the New Testament where Jesus intentionally sought out an experience of being alone. As a matter of fact, the word lonely occurs most often, nearly always actually, in referring to lonely places that Christ would seek when he needed to be alone. So being alone and lonely are not the same thing. There are some people who are alone and they don't feel lonely. There are others who can be surrounded by people and they feel disconnected, unseen, and all alone. Here's the definition of loneliness. Loneliness is a feeling of sadness due to A, not having enough relationships, or B, not experiencing a sense of connection in the relationships that you have. So there are kind of 2 ideas embedded in there. It's the amount of social contact and connection, and it's how deep that connection goes. So you can, if you have lots of relationships and none of them go deep, you're probably going to feel lonely. There are a number of factors contributing to loneliness. One is social media. One study found that participants using social media for more than 2 hours a day are double the odds of saying that they feel lonely. So the more social media you use, the more lonely you are likely to feel. And whether that relationship could go both ways. Could be that people are using social media because they feel lonely. But there's a connection somehow between social media and loneliness. And I know that for me, the more I'm on social media, the more depressed I am. So I'm trying to limit it as much as possible and not be on it so much. But that's one factor. Americans spend an average of 6 hours per day on digital media, which includes social media. That's any time you spend staring at a screen. And 1 in 3 U.S. adults, 18 and over, said they are staring at a screen almost constantly. And that gets in the way of human connection and can cause us to feel even lonelier. Social media displaces in-person engagement. It monopolizes our attention, reduces the quality of interactions, and lowers our self-esteem. So that's one reason. People move around more. So it used to be everyone kind of stayed in the community where you grew up. So you kind of grew up with a network of relationships that were always there. And now people move around more and don't have that. We have more people working remotely. People are marrying later and less. There's decreased involvement in church and other social groups. Think of all those groups that people used to join, the Elks, the Moose, whatever they were, coming to church. All of that is going down. People are becoming more isolated. And then I think polarization also contributes to this because we disconnect from people we used to connect with. And there's some people we're so polarized over politics that sometimes friendships end. And that adds to our loneliness. So I'm going to move to a section I'm calling Loneliness by the Numbers. These are some statistics. My staff at Cedarville used to always tease me about liking statistics too much. There's a joke about a statistician. Statistician is a person who could have his head frozen in a block of ice and his feet in a fire, and he would say, on average, I feel just fine. So there are some problems with statistics. You can make them say whatever. That got a few kind of chuckles. So let me give some statistics. According to the Surgeon General, loneliness has been increasing since 1976. So since 1976, in measures of loneliness, every year it has gone up with one exception. And that is that it really went up during COVID, and then it dropped back down a little bit after COVID, but it's still on an upward trend line. So loneliness has been increasing. And part of what I hope these statistics and this part of the message does is I hope it helps you know that if you are feeling lonely, you are not alone. There are many people who are feeling that. It affects about 35 to 50% of the population. There are lots of ways of measuring it, but it kind of falls into that range. Only 39% of adults in the U.S. say they feel very connected to others. The number of people reporting fewer than three friends has doubled since 1990. There's all kinds of statistical evidence that something is happening. Since 2003, the amount of time spent by people 15 to 25 in face-to-face interactions has decreased by 70%. That amounts to about 20 hours per month that they are not connected with people compared to before in face. And again, it's working remotely is a big part of that. There are lots of things contributing to that. But people are just less connected, and that contributes to it. One thing that was interesting, older people tend to be more socially isolated, but younger people report twice as much loneliness. So I think there's kind of a stereotype, well, this is something that maybe elderly people struggle with when they are left by themselves. But it's very interesting that young people were twice as likely to express high levels of loneliness. Here's one of the more interesting statistics. Go to this next one. This is not to encourage smoking, excessive drinking, or eating a couple of quarter pounders every day. So I want to give that caveat right up front. But loneliness is bad for you. And they found that in terms of your health and your longevity, and this is related to all kinds of things, heart disease, dementia, there are a whole bunch of things. High levels of loneliness is worse than smoking 15 cigarettes a day or drinking six alcoholic drinks, or overeating a lot, or physical inactivity. So there is a physical dimension to loneliness being harmful. And that's probably because it's connected with all sorts of other things. But I thought that was interesting. 29% increase in heart disease for people who are lonely, 32% increase in the risk of stroke, 50% increase in the risk of dementia, 60% increase in the risk of premature death. So loneliness is a real problem. Anyone can be lonely, but certain groups are especially susceptible. And when they study loneliness, all of this is in the Surgeon General's report, there are certain groups that are especially at risk. And those include people who are physically ill, the elderly, young people, kind of peaks out at both ends in terms of generationally, people who live alone, people with mental illness, single parents who are especially lonely, people with disabilities, and people who are financially insecure. All of those things had some connection and made people more prone to feeling lonely. And you may look at that list and say, well, there are a couple of those that apply to me. So it's not surprising that loneliness is something that's hard to deal with. When it comes to treating loneliness, there are a number of different strategies for helping people who are lonely. And the researchers came up with, there were four main ones, and then I added kind of a fifth down there on the bottom. But the four main ways of kind of helping people deal with loneliness, one was helping people develop better connection skills. Way back when I was a college counselor, I worked with a young lady who was really struggling with depression, and she did not know how to make eye contact and smile. So we would actually sit in my office and practice making eye contact and smiling. And then we got to the point where we actually go out and we would walk around campus practicing making eye contact with people and smile. She did not know how to do that. And I think this is especially true often with people who have been hurt, as she had been, is we develop strategies to protect ourselves, and then we become lonely behind the walls that we build. So there's this, I'm gonna protect myself by maybe rejecting others before they can reject me or something like that. And it kind of helps a little bit, but then it contributes to the problem because you get lonely behind those strategies. Another approach was giving social support. So some treatments of loneliness actually assigned mentors or partners to people who were lonely. Another strategy, and I think this is particularly relevant to the church, is providing more opportunities for people to connect, just making it easier for people to connect. And then the fourth was recognizing harmful thought. There's some self-defeating thoughts that go with loneliness, like no one is going to like me. No one wants to be with me. This is never going to change. And we say those things to ourselves over and over again, and that self-talk sinks us deeper into depression and more into isolation. One thing was interesting, though, is when they studied these different approaches, one thing really stood out as being more helpful than everything else, and that was volunteering. Volunteering had the biggest impact on helping people overcome loneliness. So I'll say a little bit more about that later. The other thing I threw in here that I thought was kind of interesting is hobbies that involve creativity seem to help people with loneliness. There's something, and Aaron, I expect you to answer why this is at our next class, but there's something involving creativity that seems to help people become less lonely. It triggers a part of the brain that helps us connect better. So he's nodding, so come on Thursday and he's going to let us know kind of why that happens. But those are all things that help. So that's the report part of my message. Now I'm going to shift to the sermon part of our message. What does the Bible say about loneliness? Does the Bible address this topic? And there are four things I'm going to point out. The first thing is that we are designed for relationship. God has hardwired us to need relationship. And God experiences relationship within the Trinity. That's part of a Trinitarian understanding of God, is God interacts. God the Father interacts with the Holy Spirit and Jesus the Son, and there's that interaction and social engagement within the Trinity. We are not Trinity, so we need that from one another. We are designed for relationship. Genesis 2:18 is a verse that is specifically about marriage, but I think it also relates to this issue. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a suitor, a suitable helper for him." It's interesting that in the creation account, as you read through it, everything is good. God created the sun and the moon. It was good. God created the land and the sea. It was good. God created the animals. It was good. The first thing that is not good is loneliness. Is being alone. That's the first thing that God identifies as something that is not good. There are 100 one another passages in the New Testament. A verse that includes the word one another and is talking about relationship that is to define being a part of a Christian community. So there are 100 verses where one another occurs, and in 59 of them, it's connected to a command. We're actually told to do something about or with one another. For example, Romans 12:10 says we're to be devoted to one another. Romans 12:16, we are to live in harmony with one another. Romans 15:7, we are to accept one another. We are to take care of one another. We are to serve one another. We are to show hospitality to one another. Every single one of those, in one way or another, addresses the issue of loneliness within the church. And I think there, it is one thing to be lonely when you're all alone. I think it is way harder when you are lonely in the middle of a group. And when you come on a Sunday morning and you sit and no one speaks with you or you don't make any connections, that's hard. That's worse than being lonely when you're alone. And we're going to come back to that. This is not a message just for people who are lonely. This is a message to all of us to be aware of how harmful this is in our family and to have a sense of responsibility for addressing it. Second thing is the Bible acknowledges the pain of loneliness. Now, when I was trying to put this message together, one of the challenges is that the word loneliness and lonely hardly ever occurs. There is no, like in the Old Testament, there is no natural Hebrew equivalent to the word loneliness. And there is sort of an equivalent to the word lonely, but it only occurs three times in the entire Old Testament. So that made it a little bit difficult. And in the New Testament, it gets a bit easier. But there are only two verses in the Old Testament that use the word that's kind of loosely associated with loneliness, and they are not talking about lonely people. They're talking about lonely places or things like that. But the word is kind of related to the word forgotten. So loneliness is like feeling as though you have been forgotten. There's a connection there. And then when we get to the word I always like to look at how words are put together. That's the word forgotten is actually a compound word that has two ideas put together. The idea clothed, kind of strange, isn't it? And unnoticed. Loneliness feels like being clothed in unnoticedness, to make a word up. But being unnoticed just becomes a garment that you wear, and it's heavy, and it is painful. If we shift to the word, got lost in my notes here. Okay, New Testament. When we shift to lonely, so loneliness aren't any good words. When we shift to lonely, it's a little bit better. The word lonely does occur a couple of times in the Old Testament, in the book of Psalms, and we'll read both of these before the message is over. But Psalms 25:16 says that when we are lonely, we can turn to God for help. It says, "Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted." And that word in the New Testament is a word that, again, is usually not translated lonely. It's usually translated forsaken. And forsaken is a word that means left behind. So loneliness feels like being clothed in being unnoticed, and it feels like being left behind. Everyone else is moving on, and they haven't noticed that you're not moving along with them, and everyone is just kind of leaving you. So the Bible teaches we're made for relationship. The Bible acknowledges that there's a lot of pain in loneliness. And the next point is that Jesus himself felt the pain of loneliness. Jesus gets loneliness and understands it. And again, this is a rare word to show up anywhere, but it shows up in Mark chapter 15, verses 33 to 34. Let me read the passage. "At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?'" So on the cross, of all the times for Jesus to identify with lonely people, it happened when he was on the cross. He felt the pain of loneliness as he hung on the cross. So Jesus understands our pain. Then the last point, and this is for all of us, the church must be a place where the lonely are seen and feel like part of a family. Psalm 68:6 says, "God sets the lonely in families. He brings out the prisoners with singing, but the rebellious dwell in a sun-scorched land." God places lonely people in church families, but it is the church family's responsibility to make sure that they feel as though they have been seen and know that they are loved. Some of this can happen on Sunday mornings. We need to all assume responsibility for making sure that everyone feels seen and welcomed on a Sunday morning. We all have to do that. And there are a couple of people who are really good at it. Larry Shaw and Roy Malin came to mind as being a couple of people who are very good at making sure that if it's in their power, they're going to make sure that no one leaves not having been greeted. But all of us need to do that. And just a word of advice for you. A lot of times people realize that needs to happen in the narthex. Like, oh yeah, we need to welcome people out there. It really needs to happen in here. Because a lot of people will walk through the narthex and feel greeted and then come in here and sit and feel all alone because no one speaks with them. So we need to really claim this space. And when you come in, look around and say hi to one another. Look for people you can speak with before you leave. But we really need we need to nail this on Sunday mornings, but we also need to nail it throughout the week. It's not just a Sunday morning thing. There's another verse that I think gets at this. This is Hebrews 10, 24 to 25. This has advice for both the lonely and their churches. It says, let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, all the more as you see the day approaching. To the lonely, this verse says, don't give up. Don't pull out. Don't further isolate yourself. You need the body of Christ. And to the rest of the congregation, it says, you've got to be encouraging people. You've got to be spurring. I thought it's interesting that this verse talks about spurring one another on to good deeds when research has found that doing good deeds is one of the things that is an antidote to loneliness. But we need, there's a weakness that one of our weaknesses as a church is we don't have enough volunteer opportunities that occur outside of the 9-to-5 weekday window. There are not many opportunities to volunteer in the evenings or on weekends, and that's something we need to try to figure out. Small groups are a great place to build connections with people. So again, we think about loneliness. There are two kind of ways to address it. One is get more connections. The other is make the connections that you have go deeper. And small groups are a place where that can happen. I had a guy come to me one time back when we attended Southgate Baptist down on the south side, and came up to me after a Sunday school lesson and basically said, I'm lonely. So I don't work with anyone who shares my faith. I go to work and I'm lonely. Would you have breakfast with me once a week? That takes a lot of nerve, doesn't it? I mean, that takes a lot of impetus on the part of. He went on to become one of my dearest friends. One of my closest friends today is that person. So part of my challenge, and I this is a hard one, but if you are lonely, let people know. Sometimes everyone assumes you feel connected and you don't. But please let us know so that we can try to help you with that. It matters to us that you feel lonely, and we want to be part of the solution. That is my challenge. A challenge to those who are lonely to stick with it. Engage in things that help you get connected with people. A big part of developing deeper relationships is self-disclosure. So you look at what intimacy is, and loneliness is a longing for intimacy. One of the things that builds intimacy is self-disclosure. And that's hard for some people to do. But when you talk about difficult things that you have been through or difficult things that you are dealing with, that is something that helps take relationships to a deeper level. And you can have a bunch of relationships that kind of always stay on the surface and don't really go anywhere, or you can self-disclose and be more honest, and hopefully those relationships will go deeper. Hey, let me say a prayer as the praise band comes up and is leading us into communion. We are changing the order of our service a little bit. We're moving the offering to the very end. And one reason we are doing that is we've spent some time thinking about just the flow of worship. And we go from the sermon and we kind of move into coming to the Lord's table. And then we break for the offering. And then we come back to another worship song. So we're kind of flipping that around, trying to let our worship build. And before I pray, I want to also give you a little challenge. Remember we talked about a couple weeks ago when we were talking about worship? What we do with our bodies is a huge part of worship. And this may seem strange. This may seem scary to some of us. We are predominantly a bunch of white people who came from Presbyterians and Baptists, neither of which groups move very well. But moving is a part of worship. And a couple of weeks ago, we invited people during one of the closing songs to come and to kneel in the aisle, because the Bible talks about kneeling while we worship. You can kneel in your pews if you want. You can raise your hands. For some people, it's just even swaying a little bit is a physical expression of Al. Al's practicing. He's doing a great job. That enhances our worship. So let me just kind of give you that up front as you're thinking about our service kind of drawing to a close. Let me say a prayer. Father, I want to lift up those who are lonely in our world, those who are lonely here at Central, those who are lonely in our community. May this be a place where the lonely feel as though they have been placed in a family, and a place where they are loved and valued and seen. And I ask your Holy Spirit to prompt us. Lord, you have the ability to move us. And if there are people who are lonely, may your Spirit move us into deeper relationships with those people so that they experience a sense of family. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.